Good morning.
Good morning.
It's now time for our children to play their part. What we'd like to do is, if you have any spare dollar bills, we'd like to have the children collect them and get the dollars, bring them up, and put them in the place up here. Some of that foam is in his cut. You know what that means, right? That's how rabies is transmitted. And so Wayne is now really worried because he thinks if the dog has it, now he's going to catch it. So anyway, he brings the dog to the vet's office. The vet looks at the dog, takes the vet about 30 seconds to assure Wayne that the dog doesn't have rabies. He's got a bone lodged in his throat. Okay, and he can't breathe. So the vet comes over, he doesn't even take him to the dog. They do it in the waiting room. He opens the dog's mouth, sticks his finger down the dog's throat, and pulls out a little tiny bone. And as soon as he pulled it out, the dog stopped acting crazy, stopped flopping around, and stopped foaming at the mouth. Okay? So the vet was able to save the dog's life, tell Wayne that he didn't have to worry about having rabies or have to do the test to check the dog to have rabies. So you see how the vet helped the dog and helped Wayne? Do you have anybody in your life that you know that helps you? Did your parents help you? If you were in trouble, do you know who you can call? Who?
911.
Who do you get at 911? That's true, right? So police help you, firemen help you, ambulance people help you, vets help you, your grandmas and your moms and dads, right? But listen, there is another person who we're going to talk about after we're done with the story, who came. She helps you too? She helps me too when she plays. So listen, there's another person that has come to help us, and his name is Jesus. Have you heard about him?
Yes.
Do you know how Jesus helps you?
Yes.
You know all those dollar bills that you just collected?
Yes.
Do you know who helped those people who gave those dollar bills to you get those dollar bills in the first place?
Yes.
That's right. Is that right, people?
Yes.
The Bible says that God gives you the ability to make wealth. He gives you the strength to do it. So it's God that blesses us, and it's God who hears our prayers. So just like Wayne, when he was worried about his little dog, went to the vet, if you have problems, you have things you're scared and worried about, you can always go to Jesus, and he will hear you, and he will help you.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, I thank you for these children. I pray that your Spirit will be with them, that you will bless them as they continue to grow, that you will use them in a mighty way as they grow up. But I pray that you use them now. Help them to be witnesses to you for their friends, for their family. For this we ask and pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right, you can go back to your seats. Thank you for collecting that money. Appreciate it. My phone, because I just read that story online. I wasn't sure if I was going to remember it, so it was just there for backup. This morning, I'd like to talk to you about the death and resurrection of Jesus. I'm looking for my glasses. I've got 27 pockets in this suit,
right here,
and they weren't in any of them. Turn with me to Matthew. Matthew chapter 26, verse 2, Jesus tells his disciples, "You know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified." Verse 3, "Then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas. They came together," in verse 4, "and they plotted to take Jesus by trickery and to kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar amongst the people." Jesus knew what was going to happen to him. He's been trying to prepare his disciples, and he's been telling them again and again that they were going to arrest him and they were going to crucify him. But he didn't leave it at that. He said that on the third day he would rise again. Now his disciples didn't want to hear what was going to happen to him. Not only did they not want to hear that, but I don't think they heard the last part where he said that on the third day he would rise again. Now isn't it funny that his disciples didn't hear it, but when they took him to this mockery of a trial, they got false witnesses, and the only two that agreed, they agreed on the testimony that this man said that he would destroy the temple and in 3 days would raise it again. What temple was he talking about? Right? So the wicked understood and remembered what he said. They may not have understood, but they remembered at least. But his disciples did not. What I want you to think about this morning is as we get close to what the world celebrates as Easter, and we get close to Resurrection Day, I want you to think about what Jesus went through for you. Not just the world, but for you. Because this relationship that you have with him is a personal, individual relationship. You're not saved corporately. That means that your church isn't going to save you. Your parents are not going to save you. It is Jesus Christ who saves you. And you got to know him personally.
Amen.
Individually. You come to him. You accept him. Jesus died for you. This is what keeps me going every day, is to know that my Savior loves me so much that he was willing to suffer to pay for my sin so that I could be with him throughout all eternity and live in a place where there be no more sin, no more death, no more pain, no more sorrow.
Amen.
So as we look at some of the things that Jesus suffered and dealt with, as you're reading this, have a mental picture in your mind of what he went through and realize he did it for you. At any time, he could have called his father. His father would have sent legions. He said 12. How many soldiers are in a legion? 12,000 soldiers, 12,000 angels God would have sent to take his son back. And Jesus made a choice. He made a choice to stay and to suffer so that you and I could live forever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So Matthew 26, verse 20. When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Those are his 12 disciples who will become 11 apostles. One of them was a devil. Verse 21. And now as they were eating, he said, assuredly I say to you what? So listen. Jesus took the 12, celebrated this last Passover meal with them. He knew this was it. This was the final meal. And he wanted this to be special for them. And another gospel says that before this happened, he girded himself and he washed their feet. He got to Peter and Peter said, no, Lord, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus said to him plainly, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. And then you got to love Peter because Peter said, Lord, not only my feet, but all of me. Did Peter love Jesus?
Yes.
Peter really loved Jesus, but Peter was not converted yet. Peter was still living his life out from the flesh. Even that flesh loved Jesus, but the spirit, brothers and sisters, is willing, but the flesh is what?
Weak.
Jesus understands what's going to happen. He also understands that these guys are still more worried about who's going to be number one in the kingdom than what he's about to suffer and what he's about to do to them. Now, have you ever dealt with adults who you have tried to show them over and over and over again and they just don't get it? And no matter how many times you explain it to them, they still don't get it. And have you ever become frustrated with those adults? And I'm not saying kids, because you can understand with children, but adults. And yet, this is what Jesus had to deal with from these 12 disciples, his closest friends. And they had no clue. But Jesus treats them with love, with dignity. But more than that, one of them, he says plainly, will betray him. And he knew which one. And he treated that follower with the same dignity and love as he did the other 11. Because that's the kind of love that Jesus has for us.
Amen.
So, they have the Passover or the Last Supper. Jesus institutes communion. He tells them plainly, that this bread is going to symbolize what?
Body.
His body. That would be broken for them. And then he says that the cup would symbolize what? That's going to be poured out for men. This would be the new covenant that God would make. That through what he would do, you and I could come directly to God. Now you tell me one person in the Old Testament, there are a few, who was able to come directly to God. The first one was Adam. Who came after Adam that could go directly to God? Abraham? Enoch? Because Enoch was a friend with God. And then there was Moses.
Only always through the Son.
Why were they able to come directly to God? It was because Jesus was the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. But listen, the reason why those examples are put in there for us is to show you the kind of relationship that you now have available to be able to come to God as Adam did, as Moses did, as Abraham did, and they were friends of God. You're no longer an enemy of God. Through Christ and his blood, you're a friend of God. This is what he's done for you. So listen. The supper has ended. They sing a song. They leave, and they go where? Into the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus asked his disciples to watch and to pray, and that he was going to go just a little farther ahead and pray to his Father. And he begged them to watch and pray. Why was Jesus wanting their company?
They needed the strength with God.
Say it again.
They needed the strength.
Jesus in his humanity was crying out for their comfort. He wanted their affection. He wanted them to be with him in this great trial that he wasn't facing, but that he was going through right then. Now listen, have you guys had family or friends ever let you down? When you really needed somebody, and I mean really needed somebody, you find yourself all alone. What that felt like is nothing compared to what Jesus went through. Family, friends, people will let you down. But Jesus took the sins of the world and he was being punished for what you and I did. Can you imagine being perfect and having not just one person's sin, but everybody's sin poured out on you? And that you had such a close relationship with your Father who was God, and now you're starting to be separated from him. Separated from him. And that never happened from all eternity. There was never a separation within the Godhead. And yet we come to this point in human history, and we're finding this separation take place. God separated from God. Hear ye, O Israel, the Lord our God is what? And yet at this time, no. Because one of the Godhead has become sin who knew no sin. Now, how many of you here have sinned? Raise your hand, because it should be unanimous. Everybody should have a hand up. How many of you have sinned so grievously that you knew how painful it hurt others, and it hurt yourself, and you carried that burden, and you may still carry that burden, but you know the shame and the guilt of sin. Right? You never had to pay the price for that. Right? Now, you hurt people, and you may have to go to them and make that up, but that's not paying for your sin, is it? Because in the end, there's one person that you owe that debt to. Not the one you hurt, but God himself. And it is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a holy God. Is that what Scripture says? It's only terrible if you don't have somebody who paid that debt for you. If you are in Christ, you will never pay the debt for your sin. You will never have to taste what hell really is. Jesus took that, and Jesus lived that, and Jesus died that. He who knew no sin took our sin, that we who had no righteousness could have his righteousness. Brothers and sisters, if that doesn't touch your heart, you really need to see where you stand in your relationship with God.
Amen.
Because that's the only thing that's going to break that heart of stone. Jesus came, lived, and died for you. He didn't do it for himself. He didn't do it for some grand reason to cement a name throughout all history. He died specifically for you. For what you had done, you would never be able to pay that debt.
Amen.
You were lost for all eternity, and the only thing you would face is hell. And Jesus said, I will face it for you, because I love you. Now listen, you know the story. They arrested them in the garden. Peter, who was the brave one out of all of them, he had the sword. He woke up, saw these guys around Jesus, and he just reacted. Didn't think, but reacted. And what did he do? Pulled the sword out, cut off the ear of the high priest's servants, and Jesus said, put your sword away. He who lives by the sword will what? As we get closer to the end of time, if there's one thing you remember about what Jesus said, remember what he said there. If you want to live by the sword, and die by the sword. Jesus does not call us to raise up weapons. Our weapons are not guns or knives. Our weapons are spiritual weapons. And those spiritual weapons are more powerful than any gun that was ever made. For those weapons can pull down strongholds. They can pull down governments. They will pull down anything that the devil throws against you. He doesn't call us to bear arms. He calls us to bear love. They gather, Peter cuts the high priest's servant's ear off, and what does Jesus do? Does Jesus say, hey man, you got what you deserved? He looked at that guy who came to arrest him, and he picks up the ear, and he puts it back on the man's head, and heals him. Now listen, before that happened, there's an intercourse of dialogue between Jesus and those who come. And Jesus asked them plainly, who do you seek? And they said, Jesus. And Jesus said, what?
I am.
I am. He is a supply word. He said, I am. And what happened to those guys? They fell back. They get up. Now, it didn't they fall back, they get right back up. They fell back, and they had to compose themselves. Jesus just stood there, and he's waiting. Lets them get up, and he asked them again, who do you seek? And they said, Jesus and that. And he said, I am. I tell you I am, let these other guys go. Now listen, what did those other guys do? Peter put his sword away, and then what did they do? They ran. Did Jesus run?
No.
He could have. He didn't even have to run. He knocked them down by telling who he really was. Who he really was. And he went with them willingly, knowing what they would do. So they take him, they bring him to Caiaphas and all of the leaders of the Sanhedrin, and they're bombarding him with questions. And what does he answer them? Absolutely nothing. As a sheep is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. Right?
Right.
Until the high priest got so frustrated with this guy, and so upset, that he said, I asked you, in a more English way, as God as your witness, are you Christ, the Son of the living God? And Jesus says, it's as you say. He couldn't lie, right? They had all these people that they paid to give false testimony. Now think about it. He never sinned. He never had one impure thought. And now he's being tried as a criminal. Why? Because you and I are privileged. What he endured is what you and I deserve.
Amen.
And you and I, if we're in Christ, will never have to endure that. I've talked to some of you, and some of you are worried about that judgment. You know, you want to stand before God, and that's a scary thing. If your name comes up in the pre-Advent judgment, what are you going to do? Listen, who's your advocate?
Jesus.
And Jesus is with you. Who can be against you?
Amen.
It's not that God the Father is the harsh judge and he wants to condemn you and Jesus has to talk him out of it. Jesus is not only your advocate, but Jesus is your judge.
Amen.
So when your name comes up and all these things that you've done, you know what you did, I know what I did, and there is no excusing that. I, like Jesus at his trial, I keep my mouth shut because there's nothing I can say. And all I have to do is turn to him. He says it all.
Amen.
Father, this one is with me. And the Father says, hallelujah, welcome home. Does that sound scary?
No.
Nothing to worry about if you're in Christ.
Amen.
Now listen. This is the problem with the world in 2016. There are a lot of people who say, I know Christ. I know God. We're best friends. It's not that, do you know Christ? The answer is, does Christ know you? Because in Matthew, Jesus gives a parable. And there are many people who on that day will say, Lord, Lord, did we not cast out demons in your name? Did we not do great miracles in your name? And the answer is, yes, they did. In Christ's name. But what was Jesus' answer to them? Depart from me, you who commit lawlessness. I never knew you. So brothers and sisters, the question is does Jesus know you? See, because there are many Jesuses in this world. The world worships a multitude of false Christs.
Amen.
Didn't Jesus say, beware, there be false Christs, false prophets? All those who come in my name, don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits by the word of God.
Amen.
So listen. They judge him. They get nowhere with him there. They send him to Herod. He gets nowhere. Herod sends them back. They finally, well, actually, the Sanhedrin judges them. They bring them to Pilate. Pilate realizes that he's under Herod's jurisdiction, sends them to Herod. Herod sends them back to Pilate. Jesus is taken back and forth and back and forth and back. This is the creator of the universe, and evil human people are mishandling him, not giving him any respect, not giving him any compassion.